We've already learned about how different morphemes are stored in our mental lexicon. In this module, we'll be thinking about the different kinds of ways that morphemes can be related to each other. What are the different sorts of relationships that exist within our lexicon, such that when we think of one word, other words might also be ready to be thought of, or what we call psychologically activated by hearing another one. So we'll talk about priming and errors as clues to our mental lexical organization, how this lexicon might actually exist or work in our brain. We'll talk about subset-superset relationships between lexical entries. We'll talk about synonymy and antonymy as a type of lexical relationship. And finally, we'll talk about semantic fields. So priming studies show us a lot about how morphemes might be related in the lexicon. What do I mean by a priming study? Well, this is actually itself a metaphor of priming the well, that when you pour in a little bit of water into some kinds of well, other water will start to come out. So these are actually easy to do. They're designed in psycholinguistics labs all over the country. But basically, a simple one could be this. I could show participants the word black on a screen, and I could ask participants to then click on which of a set of words that I give them are related to black. So what word is most strongly related? And I could carefully structure it so that I'm able to test different types of similarity with black. So I could measure the reaction time, how long did it take different participants to actually make that click to decide, yes, I think that this word is related. I could measure how frequently one type of word is chosen as being related to black over other types of words. And basically, once these studies are done over and over again, we see different types of relationships. So some participants will choose words like blast or blam or blab as being related to black. And this is probably because there's a strong phonological relationship. In this case, both the onset consonants and the nucleus are exactly the same. It's the phoneme b, the phoneme l, the phoneme a in the English lexicon. So these words are sort of ready to go. When I hear the word black, you can also, okay, give me words that think of the same or that start with the same sounds. People start to think of blast, blam, blah. They're able to think of those things readily. They're tightly related in the brain to black. Even words that don't share the nucleus but still share the onset will be retrievable and will be judged as being related to black, although the relationship isn't quite as strong. Words like bleak, blurb, or bliss. And then words which share the nucleus and the coda, which is called the rhyme, those are also very easy for people to do. It's very easy to ask someone, what are words that rhyme with black? And they can give you a whole list because these morphemes are stored in our lexicon such that words that rhyme with each other are connected to each other. So words like tack, crack, and smack. Now there's another type of relationship in where it's very easy for participants to sort of click on black or to decide, yes, I think this one is related. Those would be words like white, blue, red, and gray. And white would be the strongest. It's the easiest for people to click on. So this is obviously not a relationship that they mean the same thing or they mean something similar. White is in many ways the opposite of black. But because these are so often used together, they're a color word. They're both a color word. But it's also maybe true that because black and white is such a frequent collocation, these two words are used in the same context with each other all of the time, that comes quickly. Same with black and blue, black and red, even black and gray is a type of printing, but people probably just judge this to be a color. Another weaker type of relationship, but one that you can prove exists, is words like tired, tall, square, and new. So if you put these out and you carefully control the other options, people will eventually click on these because you can say something like that book is black, and you can also say that book is square or that book is new. You can actually, because these are all adjectives, people are able to see black and tired and tall and square and new are all part of the same class of words, so that's some kind of relationship. So these priming studies are a great way for us to begin to understand how might the lexicon be organized. What do I actually look up words according to? And I might be able to get to the same word black through many different paths, through its pronunciation, through its meaning, and through its domains of use. There's also lexical retrieval errors. So this is the kinds of mistakes that people make when they meant to say one word and they end up saying another. I'm sure you've experienced that same thing. Something like, he rode his bike to school tomorrow, when they meant to say clearly yesterday. Yesterday and tomorrow don't sound anything like each other, and their meaning is obviously not the same. But there's a strong relationship between that. In fact, it's such a strong relationship that it's easy to retrieve tomorrow instead of yesterday. What I've done here is torn apart three issues that, so together and apart, you'll earn her eternal grapefruit. That's obviously gratitude. So again, we're storing it by the pronunciation. I gave you my undevoted attention instead of undivided. So the phonological representation, the phonemic transcription, is actually very close between devoted and divided. It's just a matter of this O is being replaced for the diphthong I. Some even more interesting errors are when you're making up a new word that doesn't actually exist. If you meant to say stomach and you said stummy, or if you meant to say people and you said purple, what this might actually be is that you've got two words that are related not only in meaning, tummy and stomach, but also share something similar phonologically, the tum part, the tum. Or person and people have a similar meaning and they also have this P beginning sound. Slickery, evoid, as slick and slippery, or evade and avoid. So these are very telling, that says that meaning and pronunciation, form and meaning, have a lot to do with how these words might be related to each other in the mental lexicon. Another type of relationship between words is a hyponymy-hypernymy relationship. So nym is something you might not have realized. Let's do the morphology here. Hypo, well, we have hypoglycemic is not enough sugar. Nym, we have like toponym means the name of a place. Demonym means the name of a person. A synonym means a similar name. Nym is actually Greek for name. And then e is a Greek noun-forming thing of a condition, an abstract set. And hypernymy, we have hyperactive, which means very active. Hypertension means your blood pressure is too tense. You've got too high of blood pressure. So hyper means a lot of, hypo means not enough of. It actually means over and under and name. So an undername and an overname. In other words, supersets. And so we actually see that morphemes are stacked in these sort of intersecting or nested categories in our brain. You can think of this like a biological taxonomy. You might have learned that the life is divided into kingdoms. Kingdoms are divided into phyla. Phyla are divided into sort of orders and classes and genera and species and so on. And these are all kind of stacked together. So what would be a hyponym of the word monkey? That would be a subset of monkeys. Or a hypernym of the word monkey would be what are supersets that include monkeys. So Curious George is a cute example of a monkey, would be existing in the sets that are hypernyms of monkey. And he may exist in some of the sets which are hyponyms of monkey, but not all of them. So animals, mammals, these are going to be hypernyms for monkey. And so there's a strong relationship between mammal and monkey, animal and monkey. Monkey's a type of animal, monkey's a type of mammal. But tamarin is a type of monkey. So this is going to be a hyponym of monkey. It's a subset of monkeys. I think that might be the one that Curious George is supposed to be, is a tamarin. And then organisms, monkey is a subset of organisms. It's a subset of vertebrates. It's actually a subset of simians. There's apes, which are not a monkey, and then monkeys themselves. So there's words are actually related to each other in these sort of stacking ways, that there's supersets, which include others, and then there's subsets within others. Synonymy, so synonym is probably a word that you're familiar with. And there's sort of an axiom of physics that nature abhors a vacuum. There's an axiom of linguistics that languages abhor synonymy. Languages don't want it to be the case that every X is also a Y and every Y is also an X, that these two things are exactly the same group and that we would have two names for the same group. You can see why languages wouldn't like that. That would be very inefficient to have two names for exactly the same thing. As a result, there's really very few true synonyms. There's words which are similar enough in meaning that you could think that they're related, but what we often say, these are partial synonyms. So think of a word like port and haven. These are both similar in meaning in that it's like a place that ships can go into to shelter from a storm, a place where a boat could go in and could be safe and could unload goods. But we have very different sense of that. So port is something that's usually we think of for nowadays big ships like supertankers. But I would never think of a haven as a place where a supertanker lands. And a haven would be something that maybe would be like a resting, a quiet little resting place for a little rowboat or for a small sailboat. Well, actually, port is the French word that came into English. Haven is related to the German Hafen. These used to be true synonyms. Once Norman French and Anglo-Saxon German came together to form English, English was in this weird position that had two different words which meant the same thing. So over time, the language combed these words apart so that port would mean one kind of place, haven would mean a kind of another, and actually, increasingly, haven is used as a metaphorical thing, not a place for a boat at all, but any kind of place of rest. And so language, because it doesn't like having a synonym, it'll push those two words apart. Think of y'all and you guys. These are about as close to a synonym as you can get. They're both the second person plural informal pronouns in English. But there's a very clear difference between when you might say y'all and you guys. There's regional differences. There's differences in terms of what you might assume about someone's attitude, what you might assume about someone's emotion as they say this. So the language again combs these apart. Or one word might fall out of usage. So we had you was the second person formal pronoun, thou was the second person informal pronoun. But eventually, over time, that distinction between formal and informal got lost in English. And that's a very interesting story for another day. But basically, as a result, because you had two different pronouns that both meant second person informal, thou just disappeared from the language, in order to avoid having synonymy. A much more common case than true synonymy would be near synonymy, so something like rapid and fast. Why would we have both of these? Well, we keep them both even though they mean something similar because they collocate with different words. We can think of rapid transit or rapid pace. I could also think of fast pace, but fast food. It would be weird for me to say fast transit or rapid food. So what you end up getting is two words which both mean high velocity, but they're used with a different set of nouns here, these two adjectives. So they're clearly in a relationship with each other. But they start to get their preferences about what kinds of things can be rapid and what kinds of things can be fast. It would be very weird to say that runner is rapid, even though it's normal to say that runner is fast. Nevertheless, these share many features. Antonymy would be the opposite of synonymy. Antonymy would be the antonym of synonymy. Anto would be against in Greek, and nym is name. Syn is with in Greek, nym is name. So we've got with names and against names, and with and against you could think of as a great example of antonyms. You're either with me or you're against me. People might say that's a false dichotomy, a false antonym. I could be with you in some ways and against you in others, but that's where we're at. Antonymy is often gradable. Which means that it slides along a scale. So property X, this would be a scale of property X, could exist. I could have 0% Xness, then I would be at the Y end of the scale. I could have 100% Xness, and then I would be at this Z end of the scale. So let's think of some words which actually work this way, some gradable. And if these are the X properties that I'm measuring, how much darkness does something have? If it has 0% darkness, I might say, wow, that's really light. If it has 100% darkness, I would say it's dark. You can see that dark is actually built into the name for the category. I could actually say lightness as well. Height, again, 0% height might be short or low. 100% height might be tall or high. 0% sleepiness could be buzzed or jittery. 100% sleepiness would be dead to the world, sleepy, zonked. It could be lots of different things. 0% drunkenness would be sober or sobriety. 100% drunkenness could be wasted, hammered. And then you can also actually have different adjectives that would mark different points along this gradable scale. So you could obviously say kind of light, or you could say grayish to mark 50%, sort of tall, or medium height. Just drowsy would be less than slumbering, right? So these different, we have different words, different ways of using language to express different points along this gradient. And usually when you ask the question, you have to decide, is it more natural to say how Y is something or how Z is something? If I'm interested in darkness, I don't often ask how dark is it. Usually you'd say how light is it outside? Or instead of height, you don't usually ask how short is something. It's much more normal to ask how tall is something. how tall is that person? How high is that building? I wouldn't want to say how short is that person or how low is that building, unless for some reason the context was set up such that I already knew that it was short or that it was low. Reverses is a special kind of antonym where x is actually the action of undoing y, or if x is true, then it's eroding or taking away from y. So build and destroy, although these are often seen as being a kind of an antonym, the kind that they are is a reverse, that building would be undoing the act of destroying, and destroying would be undoing the act of building. Shrink and large, up and down. Are reverses gradable? Right and left, we normally don't think of as being rightness would be undoing your leftness, although that would be kind of what we call yaw, sort of going back and forth, or sort of moving 180 degrees on a horizontal plane. So this actually would be a sign of gradability. Up and down, these would be different positions on highness. So I guess up and down would be kind of a gradable antonym. My upness, going up, would be undoing the action of going down, or going down would be undoing the action of going up. Inside or outside, this isn't really gradable. Inside or outside is going to be my position relative to some sort of clear boundary or to some threshold. And so it's not a gradable continuum. I'm either inside or outside. So some of these reverses will be gradable and some aren't. Reciprocals is another kind of antonym. And this would be two different but opposite perspectives on the same event or on the same participant, like teach and learn. Teaching would be, it's not undoing learning, hopefully, it's not a reverse, but it is a reciprocal, that teaching and learning are the same event, but it's just a different perspective on that event. It's the perspective of a different actor. Over and under, my overness wouldn't be undoing my underness. It's just a matter of perspective. If two bodies are in this over-under relationship with each other, it requires a second actor, right? The over one and the under one. This is different from up and down, because up and down, you don't have to have two actors or two things. You could just have a single thing, which is moving up and down, but over or under require there to be some other reference, some other threshold. So these are in a reciprocal relationship as prepositions. Lend and borrow, again, it's a matter of perspective. It's the same event, it would be the same video playing. It's just a matter of from whose perspective am I telling the story. Guest and host, give and have, you can actually see these sort of relationships we saw in the very first unit, how these are both descended from the same Indo-European word, but they're just different reciprocal perspectives on the same act of having a person stay in a house where they don't live, or moving an object between one person and another. We saw these Greek prefixes, hyper and hypo, which are in a reciprocal relationship. Same thing with the Latin prefixes. You can actually see the HS relationship, the per, hyper in Greek, super in Latin, hypo in Greek, sub in Latin. You can see that there's this kind of relationship there. Another type of relationship is semantic field. And there's two ways in which semantic field is used. And the first way is actually often referred to as semantic domain and not actually semantic field. So this would be a set of lexical items that share a single domain of use, shared domain of use. And because they share that domain of use, there is a relationship between them. So there's nothing really similar about pencil and paper. I guess they both start with a P. But what really unites them, even though they're different kinds of things, yes, they're both countable nouns, but more importantly, these are used in a classroom. So pencil, paper, desk, whiteboard, I could start to populate this set with other things that are used for education or other things that you find in a classroom. So there is a relationship between these morphemes, and the relationship is that they share the same domain, the same field of use. Same thing with human relationship words like mother, uncle, nephew, cousin. You could teach a whole domain. So teachers often do introduce new vocabulary by trying to teach all of the words in a domain at once. The danger with that is that you're teaching some words which are very common, and you're going to teach some words which are not actually all of that common, because in a semantic field, you're going to have highly frequent words and very infrequent words in the same domain. So not all of the words in a domain might be equally important. Like a very common early language lesson is to teach learners all of the color words. Well, it turns out that the word purple is almost never used in conversation or language. Purple is an extremely rare word. So rather than teach all of the color words just because they have a semantic relationship, it might be more efficient in terms of time to just teach the colors that are used the most often, which are red, blue, green, black, and white. Bones, tibia, skull, pelvis, coccyx. Obviously, we talk about skulls much more often than we talk about tibias. This is one kind of semantic field. It's a field of bones. And then even these words, like puppy, kitty, potty, ouchie, choo-choo, what is the semantic domain that these words all share? These are all little kids' names for things. So in child speak or child language, the kids' versions of different objects that they might see in their environment. So these all share a semantic field. So it turns out if you've already said potty, it's much faster for me. I'm ready in some ways for the word kitty to appear, much more ready than I would be for the word skull to appear, even though a potty and a kitty have very little in common. But because they share a semantic domain, there is a strong relationship between these two words more than there is between potty and pelvis. Another definition for a semantic field is less related to use and more related to the actual meaning. So you could think of this question as exactly what is covered when I use this term, or exactly what is covered when I use this morpheme. What kinds of things could be a referent for this morpheme? So a concrete example of this from Russian would be the Russian word nog versus the English word leg. So in English, a leg has a very concrete beginning and ending point on the body. It ends just a little bit above my ankle, and I guess my leg starts kind of below my pelvis. And so that area between my pelvis and my ankle is my leg. Well, in Russian, it also would start at my pelvis, but it doesn't end until my actual toe tip ends. So a foot is part of a nog in Russian, where a foot is not part of a leg in English. So whereas English has two words, leg and foot, Russian only has one word, nog, which covers that whole territory. It covers everything on that appendage, both your leg and your foot. Same thing with ruka and hand. So you will see, if you look up hand in a Russian dictionary, they'll translate it as ruka, but ruka also includes my arm. It's everything from my shoulder to the tip of my middle finger, whereas hand is only from my wrist to the tip of the middle finger. So you could say ruka, although it is a translation for hand, it's actually kind of a partial mistranslation. Ruka could easily be translated as arm also. So that's very concrete, where I could actually point to physical objects and be like, the word in one language includes this set of objects and not the other. A more abstract example from Lithuanian would be not for a concrete concept like leg or hand, but for an abstract concept like friend. So this is the type of human relationship. And if you think about friend in English, this could be someone that I've spent my whole life with who knows me better than anyone else. They could be my friend. And friend could also refer to someone that I had a conversation once and I clicked friend them on Facebook. So it covers a huge terrain. There's a lot of different kinds of things that could be a possible referent for that morpheme friend. Well, the morpheme drogas or drog in Lithuanian, that as ending is a masculine ending for that. Drog would be the actual morpheme. Drog, again, if you looked in the Lithuanian English dictionary, it would be translated as friend, but the kind of, you would never use that word to describe someone that you just had liked on Facebook or were connected to in a casual way. You know, there's a saying in Lithuanian that a drogas is someone who you would go to jail for a crime that they committed. And that's really what a friend is. So this causes a lot of misunderstandings. When a Lithuanian hears an American talking about their friends, they might assume that that's a very close relationship if they have the semantic field for drogas in mind. And if an American heard a Lithuanian say that they only have three friends, they might feel really sorry for that Lithuanian. But what they mean is that they have three drogai, right, which are extremely close friends that they really value, that they really appreciate. So there's potential for misunderstanding whenever there's a mismatch of semantic fields. So we've seen lots of ways that morphemes can be related to each other in the lexicon by phonology, by domains of meaning and sort of synonymy, antonymy, hypernymy, hyponymy, and also shared fields of use in everyday life, the semantic domains of use, that meaning of semantic field, or their actual literal meaning, what they mean, that version of the word semantic